Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Crunch, Why Do I Feel So Squeezed? And Other Unsolved Economic Mysteries. Written by Jared Bernstein. Read by Erik Synnestvedt. Preface. My name is Jared, and I'm a practicing economist. I made my first graph decades ago, and while it sure felt good to see the way the bars lined up, I figured I could control the impulse. After a while, I was making several graphs and tables per hour, and talking earnestly about inflation, supply and demand curves, and Federal Reserve policy. I still thought I could stop whenever I wanted to. It hasn't worked out that way. In fact, it's gotten much worse. I now go on TV shows and have raging arguments about tax cuts, trade balances, the minimum wage, and unemployment. Maybe you've seen me while flipping through the channels. Maybe you've wondered, whatever's got this guy so wound up? I'll tell you. Economics has been hijacked by the rich and powerful, and it has been forged into a tool that is being used against the rest of us. Far too often, economists justify things many of us know to be wrong, while claiming the things we believe are critically important can't be done. I can't tell you how many times I've seen smart people with good hearts crumble in the face of economic arguments. Many of us will defer to such arguments, no matter how nuts these arguments seem, because they come shrouded in the mysterious authority of science. You might want to argue that unemployed people need a safety net when they lose their job, for example, but you're prone to back off the minute some economist points out how that will lead to European levels of unemployment, or how it will kill the person's incentive to find a job. Maybe you've wondered whether all the tax cuts targeted at wealthy investors are really so necessary, especially given that we're spending borrowed money, only to be reminded that these tax cuts will spur investment and growth. Don't you get it? The story goes, we can't afford not to cut taxes. At most, you might muster the gumption to say, well, I'm not an economist, but that doesn't sound right to me. Well, I am an economist, and if I may ironically borrow a phrase from Ronald Reagan, I'm here to help. It doesn't sound right to me either, and that's because it's wrong. I'm tired of being stuck in the studio engaging in rants with Darth Vaders with PhDs. Wouldn't it be more useful to have an open-ended, rant-free dialogue with real, everyday people about their economic questions? Maybe you've been wondering, is Social Security really going bust? And what does that mean to me? If I hire an immigrant, am I hurting a native-born worker? How much can presidents affect economic outcomes? What does GDP measure, and what does it leave out? How come childcare workers make so little? What does the Fed do anyway? What's the cost of ignoring global warming? What's a living wage? And what is up with all those high-end tax cuts? And of course, one that looms particularly large in the program that follows, why do I feel so squeezed? In the following minutes, I answer these and other questions. Though I sometimes tweak them a bit, I did not make these questions up, nor did I poll my wonky economist friends. The questions come from non-economists, mostly taken from email questionnaires and the blogosphere, where I've been having entirely too much fun talking about progressive economics and trolling for good questions. What's a good question? Good question. I've got one main criterion. A good question, in the Crunchian sense, is one that comes out of your everyday life as you interact with the economy, like the why do I feel so squeezed example before. Sometimes these questions grow out of people's run-ins with policy matters that leave them perplexed. The other night, for example, when my wife and I were burning far too many brain cells trying to figure out my employer's new healthcare plan, she started peppering me with questions about why our healthcare system is such a mess. Geez, you'd think a guy could catch a break at home. A question might involve a moral dilemma, like the predicament of the woman who wondered if she should worry about the incentives involved in giving a dollar to a homeless person. And lots of people wanted to learn what to make of key economic statistics, like gross domestic product and unemployment figures. What are they telling us? What's left out? For example, why, asked a perplexed but observant questioner, does the stock market often rise when the unemployment rate goes up? Seems counterintuitive, no? Think of this audiobook as a chance to hang out with someone who likes to tackle questions like these and promises to try to answer them in an engaging, non-jargony way. Come on, what do you say? How about it? Hey, where are you going? Get back here. Let me show you this graph. I'm just getting started. Introduction. So what is economics anyway? So a doctor tells this unfortunate woman that she has but 6 months to live. Isn't there anything I can do? She pleads. Marry an economist, the doctor replies. It won't cure the illness, but it will make the 6 months seem like 5 years. We might as well start with the basics, and I promise this won't take anywhere near 6 months. I recently completed my toughest speaking gig of the year. I taught an economics lesson to my first graders' class. The goal was to teach them the fundamental concepts of needs versus wants, goods versus services, and scarcity. These distinctions are critical, because a good working definition of economics is the following. The economy is the way we organize our society to best provide the goods and services that we need and want. Economics studies the best ways to do this. They quickly got the needs-wants distinction, but they raised some fascinating questions. They got that housing is a need, but someone then asked, "What about a mansion?" Just to be sure, I asked them if they knew what a mansion was. "A big house with lots of cobwebs," they said. They discussed that and determined that a mansion is a want, not a need. Smart kids, I thought. Anyway, all I'm saying is that anybody of any age can get this stuff. In fact, to not get it, to give up because it's too obscure, is, as I will show, a profoundly important political act, one with damaging consequences. The stakes are high, for ourselves and for those who come after us. Too high to entrust to those whose agenda is to redistribute power and resources to themselves and their friends. Am I really suggesting that evil people disguised as social scientists are out to rob us blind while we willingly sign on the dotted line because we don't get the math? No, not at all. Though many powerful political and corporate actors use economists and economic illogic to do just that. It's just that there are countless ways to organize our society to best provide the goods and services that we need and want. In other advanced economies, in those of Europe, Canada, Scandinavia, they answer this question quite differently from the way we do. For example, they take access to healthcare services out of the market, based on the beliefs A, that healthcare is a basic right in an advanced society, and B, as discussed in some detail later, that there are special attributes of healthcare that make unregulated markets a particularly inefficient, read wasteful way to deliver and provide it. And you don't have to get on a plane to learn the lesson that there are different ways to organize the economy. In other periods within our own history, we organize things differently too. This question of how we organize the economy matters a lot. It determines how the benefits of growth are distributed. Even more important, it determines who gets the opportunity to realize their potential. If the best educational opportunities go to the haves, their position relative to the have-nots will become etched in stone, as economic mobility atrophies. If those in political power believe, and act on the belief, that labor standards, like minimum wages, overtime, or the right to collectively bargain, are harmful to economic growth, then the ability of some workers to bargain for their fair share of the growing economy will evaporate, while that of others grows stronger. How we organize our economy determines how we structure our response to the challenges from environmental degradation, globalization, the lack of health coverage, and staggering wealth inequalities. When answering the questions that follow, three unifying principles kept coming up. I'll come back to these often, as I found them to be useful navigational tools, providing the intellectual and moral guideposts needed to keep us moving in the right direction, toward an economy that works best for all. Basic principles of crunch-style economics. 1. Economic outcomes are generally thought to be fair, in the sense that market forces dole out rewards to those who merit them. But that's not always the case. power, whether it's based on political clout, wealth, class, race, or gender, is also a key determinant of who gets what. 2. Economic relationships often play out in surprising ways, contradicting both basic logic and textbook theory. The path to economic truth is paved with evidence, not assumptions. 3. Since economics is concerned with finite resources, economic decisions often invoke trade-offs, choosing one outcome over another. Though these trade-offs are usually thought of as the benign outcomes of rational discourse, it's not so. See number 1. As I hope these principles suggest to you, the goal of this program is not simply to help listeners become better versed in economic discourse, though that's part of my goal. It's also to offer a new way to answer the question, how can we best organize our society to provide the things we want and need? America is a democracy, and in a democracy, we all get to weigh in on biggies like this, not just the elites and their scholarly shock troops. With that in mind, let's get to work. Crunch point. Note, each question and chapter in the audiobook ends with a crunch point, an allegedly snappy summary of the discussion. Economics is not an objective, scientific discipline. It is a set of decisions about how to produce and distribute resources and opportunities. Understanding and evaluating the logic and rationales for those decisions, while recognizing whom those decisions favor or exclude, is a big part of what this audiobook is about. To proceed with these insights foremost in our minds is the only way I know to rechannel the power of economic analysis back to the service of those who need it most, the ones in the vice grip of the crunch. 1. The big squeeze. Why do I feel so squeezed? As I solicited questions for this book, this one kept coming up in one form or another. And while I'm not happy about that, it is affirming, because it is, in my view, the great unanswered economics question of our time. It's not that middle-class people are sliding into poverty, hunger, and homelessness, though in an economy as wealthy as ours, too many people do face those conditions. The sense I got from questioners, a sense I've tried to convey in the answers I offer following, is that something is off in the new economy. We hear great economic news about financial markets, prices, profits, growth, productivity, and globalization. Yet many of us live with a weight of economic anxiety that our parents would not have recognized. Most of us are making progress as we age, but the path seems steeper than we might have expected, with deeper potholes along the way. For some of us, things we aspire to, like secure healthcare, or the ability to send our kids to a good college without taking on a lot of debt, are still within our grasp. But we have to reach farther to grab them, and it's harder to hold on. For others of us, a bit farther down the income scale, these aspirations are fading. To our surprise, we find ourselves without health coverage, or unable to afford the premiums and copayments. We're stuck in a house in a neighborhood we thought we'd have grown out of by now, with a school to which we'd rather not send our kids. And while we're working as hard as ever, that paycheck is alarmingly thin after gas and groceries. Not everyone feels that way. Raise the issue of the squeeze, and many economists and policymakers will excitedly, and correctly, remind you productivity is soaring, unemployment's historically low, inflation's down. How do I know this? Because I'm a regular on CNBC's Kudlow & Company, a show that focuses largely on stock and bond markets. It's almost infectious, the way Larry Kudlow and his guests from the world of financial markets bubble over with effusive, heartfelt praise for all those positive trends just mentioned. To them, for example, globalization means a greater supply of capital and labor, more global liquidity, lower prices, lower interest rates, and a lot more people with whom to make trades. To millions of others, globalization means greater wage competition and less job security. They're both right. I'm fortunate that these financial market mavens will at least entertain a different perspective. But no matter how many times I point out that the typical working family's purchasing power, its inflation-adjusted income, is actually down over their beloved economic boom, they can't hear me. Why not? Well, like they say, denial ain't just a river in Egypt. It's a place to which lots of economic elites retreat so that they can avoid the tough question: what's behind the divergence between the macroeconomy and the microeconomy, between stock portfolios and paychecks, between the view from Wall Street and the view from Main Street? Let us begin by presenting some evidence, and then tackle that critical question. The statistics behind the squeeze are embarrassingly easy to come by. Anybody with a mouse can stop puzzling over this after a precious few clicks. The economy grew by 15% between 2000 and 2006, but the inflation-adjusted weekly earnings of the typical or median worker were flat, down 0.7%. The median is the worker at the 50th percentile, right in the middle of the wage scale. Partly due to the jobless recovery that lasted until mid-2003, I discuss recessions and recoveries later on, the typical working-age household's income was down 5%, or $2,400, from 2000 to 2006. Their income was down more than their wage because they found fewer available hours of work. After falling steeply in the latter 1990s, the share of the population that's officially poor rose from 11.3% in 2000 to 12.3% in 2006, the most recent available data point for poverty rates. While inflation overall has been moderate since 2000, as I point out following, the costs of some of the key components of the middle-income market basket – healthcare, childcare, college tuition, housing – have been growing much faster than the overall average of all prices taken together. That's a lot of numbers, but let's not gloss over them. Over the course of this highly touted economic expansion, poverty is up, working families' real incomes are down, and some key prices are growing a lot faster than the average. Now, I know you don't hear about such numbers every day. Instead, you hear about the stock market every hour. But these statistics are not secret. It's obviously important to document the facts, but it's also useful to look beyond the statistics to people's own views about the economy. Such views jump around to some extent with highly visible indicators like gas or home prices. But in one weekly poll, ABC Washington Post, more than half of respondents have registered negative impressions about the economy since the summer of 2001. Clearly, dissatisfaction with the Iraq War dominated the 2006 midterm elections, but the economy was next in line. According to the New York Times exit poll, two-thirds of voters in November 2006 reported that they were either just maintaining their living standards, 51%, or falling behind, 17%. By 2007, 44% said they lacked the money they needed to make ends meet, up from 35% a few years earlier. Remember, this is a critical part of the story. The cheerleaders are right, in their own narrow way. While all these unsettling poll results were coming in, the economy was expanding at a good clip and generating stellar rates of productivity growth. We were achieving efficiency gains at a rate that hadn't been seen in over 30 years. The unemployment rate was low in 2006-07, below 5%. The stock market took a dive in late 2000, but by the end of 2006, it was up 56% from its 03 trough. 5 years into this recovery, corporate profits as a share of national income were at a 56-year high and were percolating along at a rate more than twice the average of past recoveries. Yet more than 4 in 10 told pollsters they were having trouble making ends meet. What this barrage of percentages is telling us is that if you feel squeezed, chances are it's because you are squeezed. Most of the indicators that matter most to us in our everyday lives – jobs, wages, mid-level incomes, prices at the pump in the grocery store, healthcare, retirement security, college tuition – are coming in at stress-inducing levels. But gross domestic product – GDP – our broadest measure of the economy's health – explained later – keeps on trucking. Something's wrong. Something fundamental. Not third-world poverty fundamental. Not blood in the streets, massive homelessness, or Great Depression fundamental. If the problem were that obvious, it would be less amorphous, less indecipherable, less of a head-scratcher. The name of the problem is economic inequality, and it's been on the rise for decades. It's at the heart of the squeeze, and it's a sign that something important is broken, the set of economic mechanisms and forces that used to broadly and fairly distribute the benefits of growth. What mechanisms am I thinking of? They are unions, minimum wages, employer and firm loyalty, global competitiveness, full employment, the robust creation of quality jobs, safety nets, and social insurance, all of which are discussed in the following program. The belief that growth should be fairly distributed, that the bakers should get their slice, is a fundamental economic value in America. It is, of course, not one we have always lived up to, especially for the least advantaged among us. But it's always there, this sense that the rising tide should lift the rowboats and the houseboats, not just the yachts. When the lesser boats founder, people know it. And that's where we are today. Bill Clinton won an election appealing to those people in 1992. Various senators and congresspeople did so in 2006. And from what you could hear as the 2008 campaign season got underway, much too early for the taste of most of us, the Democratic presidential candidates were tapping directly into the same set of values. Now, you won't hear this description of our economic challenges from most op-ed writers, any presidents, or central bankers. Their answer to the inequality question comes down to one and only one solution: more education. They believe that the reason the economy is passing so many folks by is that they don't have the smarts and skills to cash in on the opportunities we're creating. The education mantra is a clever framing because A, it rings true, you're always better off with more education, and B, it subtly puts the burden on you. The message is, the opportunities to get on the right side of the inequality tide are there, if you are smart enough. If you're not, well then either smarten up and join the parade, or stop whining. As one U.S. Treasury official put it, if the country is going to undergo economic growth, then the population has to be able to take advantage of opportunities. Or as President George W. Bush elliptically put it, we have an economy that increasingly rewards education and skills because of that education. 10 years ago, he would have been at least partly right. Today, education is neither the main cause of, nor the main solution to, the inequalities we face. I deal with this in greater detail in a later chapter. But for now, I'll assert that inequality is no longer being driven by the highly skilled pulling away from the rest of the pack. Yes, you're far better off with a college education than without, but that degree won't insulate you from global competition. Especially if your work can be digitized and offshored, there are highly skilled but low-paid workers in other countries with whom you now compete. The real wages of American college grads rose less than 2% from 2000 to 2006. Yet while college grads are beginning to feel the same competitive pinch that the blue-collar workers have felt for years, the share of income going to the top 1% of households in 2005 was at 22%, higher than in any year since 1929. Therefore, a simple big skills get big rewards story just doesn't cut it today. To understand what's behind today's inequality, something to which I devote considerable time in the coming program, you've got to deal with principle number one: power. More so than in any recent period, those who hold a privileged position in the economic power hierarchy, the players who sit down at the poker table with a stack of chips reaching to the ceiling, the CEOs and the holders of large capital assets, are able to steer the bulk of growth their way. Then, using their political connections, they're able to ice the cake with a nice bit of after-tax redistribution, as regressive changes in the tax code funnel even more resources their way. The rest of us, those who sit down with a modest stack of chips, are left trying to figure out, well, like it says in the title, why do I feel so squeezed? Crunch point. You feel squeezed because you are squeezed. If this were just a growth problem, we could have a nice, polite discussion of ways to get productivity humming again, or how to bring down the unemployment rate. But productivity's been great and unemployment's low. The squeeze is on, and we won't be able to call it off until we deal with our inequality problem. Econ Noir. Before wading more deeply into the ideology of the crunch, how about a nice mystery story? I've always enjoyed the noir style in films and books, where gritty gumshoes pursue mysterious ladies while snarled in deeply tangled plots. One evening, while struggling to reconcile the growing economy with falling wages, I felt unusually close to Humphrey Bogart and wrote this story. In the next chapter, I explain the concept of gross domestic product in greater depth, but it's simply our broadest measure of economy-wide growth. I also mention Ben Bernanke, chairman of the Federal Reserve, in the story. I was working late in my D.C. office. I'd been running some new simulations on my macro model, but nothing was converging, so I figured I'd close up my spreadsheet and find a corner in some dark speakeasy to lick my wounds. That's when she walked in. She had a neckline as low as the NASDAQ in 01, curves like sine waves, and a dress tighter than the global oil supply. She had my attention even before she pulled out two reports I'd seen that very morning. "I'm sorry to barge in on you like this," she said in a voice that gave my calculator a power surge. "I didn't know where else to turn."
"You came to the right place, doll," I said. "I see you've got the first quarter GDP report, along with the new compensation results." I'd been puzzling over these numbers all day, but what, I wondered, could this tall glass of cool water want with them?
"That's right," she purred. "I need to know why GDP is up 4.8%, the strongest quarter since 2003, yet real wages are falling."
"Yeah," I thought, "you and everybody else who works for a living." "Why the interest?" I shot back. She didn't look like a Democrat.
"I wish I could tell you, but I work for some powerful people."
Now I knew she wasn't a Democrat,
and they'd be very upset if they knew I was here.
"Why me? Why don't you ask your powerful friends to explain why the economy's racing ahead, by leaving working stiffs behind?" She got kinda sulky, and I kinda liked it.
"They wouldn't know where to look. What's worse, most of them think it's great when wage growth decelerates, because with no inflationary pressure from labor costs, it means the Fed can take a powder on rate increases."
"Tell me about it, sister. I've been leaning on Bernanke for months on that point, but he doesn't return my calls." Needless to say, I took the case. I wasn't sure what game Little Miss Conflicting Reports was playing, but I figured I'd play along for now. Fact is, I'd been asking the same question myself. Every quarter we seemed to be getting great news on top-line statistics, GDP, productivity, profits. Yet the typical worker's real earnings were down 2% over the recovery. Guys like me don't like it when things line up that way. I headed for the union hall, figuring some of those people might have an angle. Problem was, with private sector unions down to 8% of the workforce, the hall had become a Starbucks. I got a vanilla chai latte to go and beat it. I decided to head for the new economy, so I looked up some managers and professionals in the service sector. I found them all right, but they didn't have any answers. As of the first quarter of 2006, their compensation had lagged inflation for three quarters running. This was more serious than I'd thought. Whatever was driving a wedge between overall growth and living standards, it was reaching pretty high up the pay scale. I wasn't sure what mess I'd gotten into here, but it was time to confront the doll that got me into it. I caught up with her in her penthouse, a place that had a housing bubble written all over it. I know my wealth distributions, and this kitten came from the top 0.1%. I don't like playing the sap. It was time for some class warfare. "Okay, gorgeous. Drop the Two Americas line and give it to me straight. You know as well as I do where the growth is going. What's your game?" She nibbled her lip and looked up at me real sweet.
"I suppose if I told you I'm just a girl who cares about the bottom 99%, you wouldn't believe me."
She supposed right.
"All right, I'll come clean," she said, slumping in a chaise longue that probably cost the average income of the bottom fifth. "I work for the Republican National Committee, and we're starting to get spooked by the president's poll numbers on the economy. We figured if we don't get a little trickle-down soon, it could hurt us in 2006, not to mention 08.
I kicked myself for not seeing it sooner. "So you don't give a damn about the structural factors driving the productivity wage gap, The declining unions, low minimum wage, the profit squeeze, slack job creation, and most of all, the way globalization is sapping the bargaining clout of the American worker, blue and white collar alike.
"Why should I?" she said, finally showing her true colors. "Any intervention would just cuff the invisible hand, doing more harm than good."
She was Milton Friedman with a body of Scarlett Johansson. I had to get out of there. "You're wrong," I shouted, staggering toward the door. "You can't see it, but these two reports are a microcosm of everything that's right and wrong with this economy. Tell your people that whoever understands and articulates this disconnect, along with offering a convincing policy agenda to reconnect growth and living standards, that's who wins the big tamale." I was wasting my breath. She had me bounced by a security guard as pumped up as ExxonMobil's profits. I brushed the dust off my suit and headed for the office. You'd think a case like this would be dispiriting to a guy like me, but you'd be wrong. Sure, she'd made me mad, but I saw things clearly now, and her little scheme was about to backfire. There's an electorate out there that's looking for some economic stewardship. Maybe I'm just one economist in this big, crazy city, and maybe the other guys have got the deep pockets. But the way I see it, we can shape our economic outcomes so that everyone gets a fair shake, not just the chosen few. I opened up a spreadsheet and got to work. All is not as it appears. Measuring economic outcomes. Okay, that squeeze stuff is pretty convincing, but I hear a lot of cheerleaders touting a different set of facts, and once economists start throwing these numbers around, I'm lost. How can I tell if presidents, politicians, economists are giving it to me straight? What's the right scorecard? That's a great and critical question, one that reminds me of my days teaching statistics. On day one of the course, we'd have a wide-ranging discussion about the use of statistics in society, and someone always, and I mean without exception, raised the argument that statistics was a fancy way to make stuff up. I lay in wait for this argument, and my response was that, in fact, the point of learning this stuff was to be able to distinguish between bad and good statistics. My sense at the time was that my explanation probably convinced only a precious few, but the idea is an important one for our journey through Crunchland. Folks on cable news shows aren't the only ones who selectively pick which facts they want to feature about the economy. Presidents do too, and that creates a lot of cognitive dissonance among those stuck in the crunch. Here's a scorecard to help square the difference between what you hear and what you see. Like the rooster who's sure his crowing caused the sunrise, presidents, regardless of party, this is not, I repeat, not a partisan critique, though I am fully capable of such critiques, and you'll bump into more than a few along the way, will always take credit for anything good that happens in the economy. And they're not above picking the cherry tree clean to do so. To do so, they generally use three methods: strategic clock starting, broad averages, and bars so low that even they can get over them. A posting on the White House website. "Hey, didn't you just say something about this not being a partisan attack?" "Yes, but I'm picking on Bush here because since he's the prez, his spin is a mouse click away. And truth be told, his folks engage in this stuff more than most." Accessed in November 2007, for example, makes the following claims. More than 8.31 million jobs created since August 2003. Granted, you may annoy anyone within a hearing distance, but when economists start spouting numbers, remember this invaluable question. Compared to what? More than 8.31 million sounds big, right? But in a workforce of 150 million, it's a rate of job growth that's actually well behind the historical average. It also comes after years of employment losses, even as the economy expanded. Another example of the disconnect we face today. Since economic data series tend to fluctuate with the business cycle, trending negative in recessions and improving over recoveries, you can make any data series sing whatever tune you want if you start counting at a carefully chosen point in time. When looking at longer-term trends, economists avoid this bias by comparing similar points in the business cycle, the most common being peak to peak. It's analogous to when you weigh yourself. If you wanted to convince yourself you were losing weight, You'd take your baseline weight right after a big meal, then check your progress first thing in the morning. Hey, I'm going to try that. In this case, the Bush League econ wizards, recognizing that their boy had presided over the worst jobless recovery on record, though the recession was over in November 2001, we kept losing jobs until August 2003, started the clock in August 2003. If they'd done it the right way, they'd have to report that job growth over the Bush cycle has been the worst on record, going back to the 1940s. Real wages rose 1.2% over the past 12 months. Ah, the soft bigotry of low expectations. 1% real growth isn't nothing, but it's way too close for comfort. And anyway, compared to what? See, you can start using that one right away. Real wages were no higher when the White House made this announcement than they were 3 years earlier. Real wages fell from 2004 through the first half of 2006. And over the longer term, wage growth for different groups of workers should always be compared with productivity, answering the question, are the bakers getting a fair slice of the pie? Over the business cycle from 2001 to 2007, real wages were up 2.3%, compared with 18% for productivity, a sure sign that slices were not growing in proportion to the pie. That's a gain of about 40 cents per hour. The average wage was $17.24 in April 2007, or around $800 for a full-year worker over 6 years, $133 per year. If your benchmark for success is essentially zero, then you'll pop the champagne cork for even the most marginal gain. Again, that's what presidents do, and not just this president. Back in Bill Clinton's first term, my organization published a critical review of the administration's claims about the quality of jobs they'd created, that is, created on their watch. They pointed out that lots of the new jobs were in higher-paying occupations. We showed that, A, this is almost always the case, occupation upgrading is the norm, note the use of the classic compared to what technique, and B, many of these supposedly good jobs were paying less than they used to. Note, back then we got invited over to the White House for a nice lunch, wherein we spoke earnestly about our competing analyses. I waited and waited to hear from the Bushies, but my wait was in vain. Real after-tax income per person has risen by 12.7%, more than $3,800 per person since the president took office. Another classic tactic. Cite broad averages, ignoring the fact that the benefits of growth have been anything but broadly shared. Exacerbate the crime by implying that they have $3,800 per person. Imagine an economy with five people, each of whom earns respectively $1, $2, $3, $4, $5. The average and the median are both $3. Now imagine that the income of the top person jumps to $100. The average is now $22, $4 more per person, but the median is still $3. In other words, the median is insensitive to big jumps at the top. Unfortunately, this is no thought experiment. It's representative of the growth concentration that occurred through the first half of the 2000s. Crunch point. In the interest of statistical inoculation, invoke these simple rules when presidents and sundry economic types start throwing numbers around. Ask compared to what? Most economic variables grow most of the time, so the question is not whether X, employment, incomes, wealth, and so on, is growing, but by how much relative to what we'd expect in normal times. Don't be moved by large numbers with no historical context. Broad averages, such as income per person, are distorted by the huge values of the richest households. So remember this handy rhyme. When it's inequality you're seeing, don't use the average, use the median. Whatever happened to the cleavers? My dad had a full-time job, but my mom didn't, and they managed to raise, feed, house, and educate two kids on one salary. I can't do that today. Why not? What happened? What happened was that the real earnings of lots of people, mostly male people, so husbands in this case, started to slip. At the same time, some of the very costs mentioned, a home and a college education, grew a lot faster than average inflation. and the fact that this questioner is from San Francisco makes a difference here, especially regarding home prices. That's bad. Also, over the last 30 years, the job market has opened up much more for women, who have made impressive gains that have helped to offset their husband's wage stagnation. That's good. But it also means that family members are spending a lot more time in the job market. That's bad. Or at least, it's stressful. There are three problems here and one positive development. Problem one, men's earnings. The hourly earnings of some men, and not a trivially small group, have done poorly over the last few decades. The typical married man in his prime earning years, age 25 to 54, saw his real median wage fall a couple of percent from 1979 to 2006. His female counterpart made a lot more progress. Her real hourly wage rose 30%, and she also worked a lot more hours. And if we cut the data a little further and look at husbands with at most a high school degree, and only a minority of husbands were college educated over these years, 16% in the mid-1970s, 30% today, we find a real wage loss of 8% over these 27 years. But before you spouses out there start humming "Hit the Road, Jack," recognize that it's not their fault. These men have been caught in the crossfire of a set of trends that have ripped the bottom out of their earnings capacity. The loss of unionized factory jobs has meant the slow bleed of high productivity jobs in a sector where these guys had some bargaining power, clout that enabled them to channel some of that growth into the household. The fact is, when a man goes from making stuff to providing services, especially a man without a college degree, his wage falls between 15 and 20%, and he loses most of his fringes. What explains a loss of that magnitude? It's not just the difference in the efficiencies between the two sectors, the so-called productivity differential, the fact that services create less value added per hour than factory work. It's also that there's a lot more wage inequality in services, and when income grows in that sector, it tends to flow to the top. That's where you most clearly see men's loss of bargaining power playing out. And outside of the public sector, unions have been hard-pressed to get a foothold in services. Walmart has shut down operations rather than entertain the possibility of their workers forming a union. At any rate, given that most of these men were working full-time, full year, families had one legal strategy to undertake if they wanted to offset those negative male wage trends: more work by wives. Problem two and good development.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.